Literature is not an ornament, a pleasant pastime, a pretty flower. Literature is a weapon to struggle against injustice. Zabel Yessayan was born in 1878 in Skudari, Polis, on the Asian side of the Bosphorus. She learned to read before the age of four. She only had 4 years of primary school. We know quite a bit about her childhood because she wrote about it in her memoir, Silidari Bardeznera, The Gardens of Silidar. She wrote this book in her 50s while she was living in Soviet Armenia. In Silidari Bardeznera, we learn about the powerful influence of her father.
My father treated everyone's dignity with the same respect and consideration, and strongly protested if he saw someone try to trample on somebody else's pride. He didn't discriminate against people. Wealth, especially not wealth, class, and nationality were not factors in determining his opinion of a person. My father's words, which were inspired by his moral principles, gave me immense satisfaction. His explanations and suggestions calmed my teenage restlessness and gradually managed to establish order in the chaos that governed me. Under the spell of my father's words, harmony would spread through me, and gradually I would find inner peace. In my long, eventful life, many people have had a great influence on me. Some have even managed to change the course of my life. But only my father, both with his words and with his example, has shaped me in a truly profound and fundamental way.
Zabel Yessayan grew up in a large extended family that often teetered on financial disaster. She got a lot of attention as a young girl because she was the oldest of three girls and she was quite sickly. But that changed dramatically. As she grew older, she found herself often fighting with her elders. She also fought with children her own age.
This is from a passage in the memoir where she's describing all of the trials and tribulations that she faces as a student in her neighborhood school. By the time I was in school, I had turned into a kind of menace that they no longer knew how to control. No one, not the teachers who liked me, or even my own father, had found a way to give me direction or channel the energy that propelled me forward. My personality was met with fierce resistance. I was continually forced to fight both physically and mentally, but I never thought the fight was beyond my capability. I had no intention of retreating. I was in a constant struggle against my family, my school, and my peers. I would sometimes experience a temporary victory, but I would more often experience defeat. These losses would not embitter me or cause me to lose hope. I would absorb the defeat, neutralize it, immediately accept that I had lost, and start a new fight. That approach became a necessity in my life, even as an adult. Even as an adult, I found myself behaving in much the same way in many other circumstances and situations.
At the age of 17, Yessayan published her first articles and actually short stories and poems. Also, at the age of 17, she went abroad to study at the Sorbonne. As far as we know, she's the first Ottoman woman to pursue higher education overseas. While she was in France, she not only studied at the Sorbonne, she continued to write. She wrote her first novel, The Waiting Room. It's a book about a young North African Jewish emigre who moves to Paris and finds discrimination and isolation. She married Dikran Yessayan, a man she had met in Bolis, and she has her first daughter, her first child, a daughter, and then she moves back to Bolis and throws herself into the Armenian literary life of the city. She became the editor of the women's pages of the journal Zavik. She wrote novels at the same time, and she created a lot of controversy. One of her novels, Gelds Hanjarner, or Phony Geniuses, was a satire of her fellow Armenian writers in the city. The story created an uproar, and they had to discontinue publication. The Patriarchate of Constantinople asked Zabel Yessayan to go to Adana after the massacres in April of 1909. She went to Adana with a delegation and was there for 3 months, providing relief for the orphans and the widows. She worked on behalf of the Armenian delegation. She met with foreign dignitaries, with missionaries. She also met with local Turkish leaders, including Cemal Pasha. He wanted only to speak with her as a member of the Armenian delegation. For whatever reason, he didn't trust the other members. As you know, Cemal Pasha became one of the architects of the Armenian genocide. Yessayan in Adana also interceded on behalf of the prisoners. And she spoke not only and helped the Armenian prisoners, but the Turkish prisoners as well. She returned to Bolis and wrote her book about her experiences and observation. Averagneru Meç, In the Ruins. In this book, she actually recorded the eyewitness testimony, the words of the victims who had survived. She also wrote about the proud resistance of the Armenians of Dortyol, or Çork Mazvan. In her preface, she tells us why she wrote the book. She was reaching out to the entire Ottoman population. She describes herself as a free citizen and true child of this land, endowed with the same rights and duties as everyone else. And she also says, if we do not see our bleeding country in its true colors, tyranny will return over and over again. One of Zabel Yessayan's greatest attributes was her fearlessness. She was not afraid to speak her mind.
This next excerpt is from an essay called Pavagane, or Enough is Enough. And the full translation will be published in the anthology that you just heard Melissa and Lerna talk about. Yessayan sets this essay in 1912, right at the beginning of the Balkan Wars. At this time, she's living in Constantinople, and she's seeing wave after wave of Muslim refugees flood into her city. You'll hear in the excerpt that their plight reminds her of something. And this something is exactly what Judy just talked about, her experience in Adana 3 years earlier. With this piece, Yessayan is trying to appeal to her Armenian readers to feel compassion for a people who may seem very different from them in religion, in language, and in custom, but whose suffering is nearly identical to the suffering that they felt only 3 years earlier. The morning is gray and foggy, and in the freezing air, a kind of unusual noise can be heard, like the uproar of a crowd. These are the Balkan refugees setting out for the interior of Asia. It's an unending succession of wagons covered with straw mats and carts, in which women, children, and the elderly move, packed close like animals. What is there in me and in them that makes us similar and brings us into harmony? The terror in their expressions awakens in me a deep, familiar pain, an unforgettable grief that has only just been assuaged. I clearly see in my painful memories evenings in a different land, where we saw in front of us a drifting sea of people struck by tragedy. If enemies knew that in days of misfortune we would look the same, that the same soul would let out the same sighs, and the same sobbing curses and same pleas would be uttered in the same tone of voice, perhaps an impossible harmony and brotherhood could be possible in the greatest of misery. My soul suddenly breaks free from its chains, and a pervading, profound, and incomprehensible feeling imbues me entirely with an unreserved sadness for human misery. It's as if a centuries-old voice is talking to me, and in that voice, I proudly recognize the spirit of my Armenians, peaceful, luminous, and forgiving.
In April of 1915, Zabel Yessayan was targeted for arrest and deportation. She wasn't at home when they came for her. She managed to go into hiding and escape to Bulgaria, then to Tiflis, and finally to Baku. And in Baku, she took down eyewitness accounts of the genocide. She published the very first eyewitness account of a man named Haig Toroyan. The name of this book is Jorovortima Hokevarta, The Agonies of a People. And she wrote this book in the passionate first person that she often used. It was as if Haig Toroyan was standing there telling her his story. In 1919, Boros Nubar Pasha asked Zabel Yessayan to come to Paris to speak at the Paris Peace Conference. She spoke about the enslavement of Armenian women and children in Muslim households. She returned to Paris and to France to live for a while, but she didn't want to stay there long. She couldn't find herself staying for the rest of her life living in the diaspora. She decided to return, or to go, for the second time. She had visited in 1926-27. She decided to move to Soviet Armenia in 1933. There she taught at the university. She wrote one of her best works, Silidari Bardeznera. And then in 1937, she was arrested by Stalin's henchmen and put in prison. She was sentenced to death. But this didn't stop Zabel Yessayan. She wrote a letter in protest to the highest levels of the military courts in Russia, protesting her conviction. They commuted her sentence to 10 years in a labor camp. Yessayan managed to survive for 5, possibly 6 years in prison, and then disappeared without a trace. That's the end of the first half of the story. The second half of the story is about the resurgence in interest in Zabel Yessayan. Many of you have probably seen the documentary Finding Zabel Yessayan, created by Lara Aharonyan and Talin Suchian. There's another documentary as well. There are many translations of her works into English, into French, into Italian, and into Turkish. There's a group of women in Turkey who are creating a play about Zabel Yessayan's life. They first performed it on the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide. They are now rewriting it and recreating it and performing it again. And that is creating a lot of controversy. But there's no surprise in that. A street in France, actually in Paris, was recently named after Zabel Yessayan. It's near the Père Lachaise Cemetery. Recently, the mayor of Paris announced this good news. And most recently, as Eric mentioned, a school in Arajamur, in Artsakh, was named after Zabel Yessayan. And I just returned from Arajamur, where 2 weeks ago, we announced the launch of the Human Rights Essay Contest based on the legacy of Zabel Yessayan. This contest is geared towards high school students in Artsakh from the 9th to 12th grade. They will be reading excerpts from Silidari Bardeznera, in Armenian, of course, and they will write essays. And the winners will be announced on December 10th, International Human Rights Day. So keep your eyes and ears peeled, because that should be very exciting news. When Salpi asked us to speak today, she asked us to think about questions of relearning and reteaching Armenian history so that it is relevant today. Reading the works of Zabel Yessayan is a wonderful example of how we can do that. Her literary output, her political activism, her resilience, and her fierce struggle for human rights resonate today, not only with Armenians, but with people around the world. Zabel Yessayan is a universal figure. She serves as a role model and an inspiration to us all. Thank you.
Thank you.